Okay, so Ishan, me and Saklani sir will proceed ahead with your mock for IISc Bangalore for two departments, aerospace and mechanical engineering, both for MTech research, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so Ishan, before we proceed, we want your very brief academic introduction.
Yes, sir. Sir, I have done my graduation in mechanical engineering from NIT Kurukshetra and I've secured 9 CGPA out of 10. And I have been doing excellently well in all throughout my academic career, having secured 10 CGP in class 10 and in 12 I secured 93.2%.
So with these credentials, from where you got call so far other than IISc?
Sir, I have filled IISc only and some of the IITs, but I have not filled any research program, so no interview call yet, sir, because I have filled only MTech.
Any particular area of research in which you are interested in IISc?
Yes, sir. Sir, in my BTech curriculum, we had to go through the basics of fluid mechanics, heat transfer. So I am interested in doing research in that area. But having said that, I am also interested in subjects like strength of material. So right now I don't have the knowledge to decide what is best for me, but these are the areas that I am very much interested about.
So what are your favorite subjects, Ishan?
Sir, fluid mechanics, heat transfer, strength of material.
Okay, so I think I'll start with the fluid mechanics and then we proceed forward for other subjects. So, yes. Which part of fluid mechanics you are more comfortable?
Sir, dynamics part.
Okay, so let me ask you, have you used Bernoulli equation at two sections?
Yes, sir.
Okay, how do you decide the potential gradient at the two sections?
Sir, for a fluid to flow, we should know the total energy line. So basically, a fluid always flow from high energy to low energy. So we should figure out at which section the total energy is higher or total energy head is higher. And after we calculate...
My question is, suppose I give you two sections of the pipe where you have to use the Bernoulli equation. So there are certain terms in Bernoulli equation. Z1, Z2 terms are also there.
Yes.
Where do you calculate Z1, Z2? That is my question.
Sir, when the sections are at different altitudes, sir. At that point, we calculate Z1,
pipe ke Z2. Center mein lete ho, ya pipe ke edge pe lete ho, kahan pe lete ho, Z1, Z2?
Sir, pipe ke center. Yes, sir.
Center mein kyun lete ho? Why only at the center?
Sir, because center mein viscous flow nahi hota hai. Kyunki usme jo shear force hota hai, wo zero hota hai. So, and Bernoulli, in Bernoulli, there are assumptions that it should be irrotational and there should not be viscous effective. So, in center line only, there is no viscous effect.
Okay. Do you really think that is the reason?
Sir, theoretically, we can say this is the reason, but practically...
How do you define streamline, Ishan?
Sir, streamline is an imaginary line which is drawn in a space, which when, at any point, if we draw the tangent to this line, we get the velocity vectors.
So, the significance of that is?
Sir, the significance of this is like for any flow, like when we do simulation in ANSYS or like we do flow visualization. So in flow visualization, basically we put a die and see how the fluid particle is moving. So depending on the streamline, we can analyze what kind of flow it is having, sir.
Okay, Ishan, tell me, what are the assumptions behind Bernoulli equation?
The assumptions are, first of all, it should be incompressible fluid. the viscous effect should not be there.
Mm-hmm.
And so again, irrotational flow is there, which is again derivable from that.
Mm-hmm.
It should be steady flow, sir. And mm-hmm. but most importantly, Bernoulli equation should be applied in the streamline, not across the streamline.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so suppose I give you two graphs.
Yes, sir.
Y is inversely proportional to X.
Yes, sir.
And Y is inversely proportional to X square. How do you draw these two graphs?
Sir, first of all, this is the hyperbolic graph. So let us take up.
Can you draw both these graphs on a page and show me?
Yes.
On the same diagram, you draw both these graphs.
Yes. Yes, sir. Yes.
Bring
visible,
close.
Sir?
No, it is not visible. 1 by x square, 1 by x. Okay, so why this merging point?
Sir, it is the merging point is 1, comma 1. So both the graphs will intersect at that point.
Why? Do you think
the
intersection will be there?
Sir, the graph where, let me please confirm, sir. One, y equal to 1 by x and y equal to 1 by x squared, right, sir?
Yes.
Yes, sir. So 1 comma 1 would be the point of intersection.
Okay. 1 comma 1 will be the point where they will intersecting. Okay. So
yes,
tell
sir.
Me, like, can you tell me the this Navier-Stokes equation, how it is different from Bernoulli equation?
Yes, sir. Sir, the Bernoulli equation is basically conservation of energy,
mm-hmm.
right? And it does the fundamental of Bernoulli equation lies in Euler equation,
mm-hmm.
which is derived on the basis of two forces, which is
mm-hmm.
gravitational forces and pressure forces, and as a result of which we can also say inertia force.
Mm-hmm.
But Navier-Stokes equation is conservation of momentum.
Mm.
And this is based on three forces, which is viscous force, gravitational force, and pressure force, and
mm.
also the resultant inertia force due to.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so suppose I give you a raindrop falling.
Yes, sir.
And you have to write the Bernoulli equation for that. How shall you write that?
Raindrop falling, what about the ambient environment, sir? Is there any air or some kind of
no, assume that there is no
detrimental
effect. No airflow.
No air. Okay.
No
so
air flow,
in a
static air.
In vacuum.
Hmm.
In vacuum, it is there or
not? Vacuum. Air is there, but there is no airflow.
Okay. So there would be now viscous forces or drag forces would be there. So I we can't apply Bernoulli equation here, sir.
Okay, tell me. I give you two states, state 1, state 2. How shall you write Bernoulli equation?
Okay, so assuming the pressure to be same,
mm-hmm.
because so the pressure terms is cancelled out. So we can as a whole, we can see the liquid as a lumped mass. And if you see the liquid as a lumped mass, it would be V1 square minus V2 square by 2G equal to H. And H is the height.
Okay. What about the energy losses?
Sir, the energy losses, viscous losses would be proportional.
Drag
to
force
the
is a friction force for vapor drop, right?
Yes, sir.
And that drag force does some work.
Drag force? Yes, sir. Drag force.
Work.
Yes. So it would be proportional to V square.
No, loss of potential energy is not always equal to gain of kinetic energy. If I don't assume anything, then loss of potential energy is equal to gain of kinetic energy. Something like if I drop this pen.
Yes, sir.
If I drop this pen and ask you to write Bernoulli equation, it is loss of potential energy is equal to gain of kinetic energy. But now this is a drop of water. Tell me, what are the additional factors which will come into picture?
Sir, one of the factors is, as you said, the skin friction.
Yes, done.
Between the air and the, then there would be, sir, due to pressure.
Drag force we can calculate, right?
Yes, sir.
Multiply by distance.
Drag force we can calculate, sir.
Multiply by that distance it traveled.
Yes, sir. So we'll get
the loss of energy.
Loss of energy. And again, there, like, as we said, a drain drop is droplet. So it is not a streamlined body. So there would be.
Tell me, is the mass going to remain constant?
Sir, mass.
Are you assuming constant mass?
Sir, again, like, this is a very subjective question. So there might be a condition that the droplet might burst out because of difference of pressure, like due to air resistance. So I'm assuming that.
Are you considering vaporization also?
No, sir.
But don't you think there will be vaporization? Water drop is coming from air. There's a relative velocity. No, yes, because of that, there is a vaporization. Understand? Some part of water drop will get into vaporized state because of the relative air motion. This is a relative air motion,
sir.
Right?
Yes, sir. This can happen, sir.
This will happen for sure.
Okay, sir. So the mass loss is also there. Mm-hmm. So skin friction coefficient, skin friction or loss.
What about the heat temperature? Uska kam hota jayega.
Temperature kam hoga, sir. But Bernoulli equation mein हम जब तक स्टेडी फ्लो नहीं लगाते तब उसका इफेक्ट नहीं आएगा क्योंकि बर्नौली इक्वेशन इज अबाउट कंजर्वेशन ऑफ मैकेनिकल एनर्जी सर
सो वी डोंट कंसीडर हीट एनर्जी इन दैट
सर बिकॉज इट इज डिराइव्ड फ्रॉम द यूलर इक्वेशन व्हिच इज कंजर्वेशन ऑफ मोमेंटम बट इफ यू कंसीडर स्टेडी स्टेट इक्वेशन बिटवीन द टू पॉइंट्स यस वी विल हैव टू कंसीडर ऑल द फैक्टर्स
ओके हाउ कैन आई कैन कंसीडर हीट फैक्टर इफ आई एम टू कंसीडर हीट ट्रांसफर फैक्टर इनटू दिस हाउ शैल आई डू दैट
Sir, I'll calculate the average velocity between two because velocity is changing. So with that velocity, I can calculate the Reynolds number and assume that this flow is forced convection flow. So assuming then, and the critical dimension is, characteristic dimension is D, the diameter of the drop. So we can calculate the Nusselt number, and based on the Nusselt number, we can calculate the heat transfer coefficient.
Will you consider surface tension as a property in the analysis?
During the heat transfer, sir?
During any analysis?
Yes, sir. We'll have to consider because when the dimension of droplet is very small and there, surface tension is very much predominant, sir.
Mm-hmm.
So Weber number will also be considered.
So tell me why this entire analysis is to be done. What will be the application of this? If I'm doing this entire analysis, what is the application of that? Why, as engineer, I'm analyzing this, or as scientist, I'm analyzing this all?
Sir, one of the effect can be the cooling tower when the droplets come down. So it is very important to know how. What are the losses and what are the like heat transfer for any droplet so that you can integrate over the whole mass.
What about rainfall? Actual rainfall, how can we get benefited from this analysis? Suppose you analyzed it in detail, what is the temperature of the drop? What is the analysis? What is the energy losses? How much is the mass loss? You analyze this all. Now tell me where it is going to help you in real world.
In rainfall, sir, I'm okay. So, like, if you talk about the heat transfer, too, we can find out the change in
any idea how current. This entire thing happens. I mean, how this rainfall takes place. What is this weather phenomena? Any idea about that? What is the physics behind this? Yeah.
Yes, sir. Like I am not, I don't have 100% clarity, but I have an idea how it works. So basically, the cloud when the cloud burst out, so the
cloud rain bursting is different thing. I'm talking about the rain, not cloud bursting.
So rain.
Maybe you can link it with the
condensation. And,
yeah.
So when the temperature is becomes less, so the like it tends to convert in into liquid. So
what was your BTech final year project, Ishan?
Sir, my BTech final year project was on a comprehensive study on the flow past a rotating cylinder.
So how did you calculate stagnant point in that? How many stagnant points were there?
Sir, the stagnant points were only one.
It depends on what parameters?
Sir, the stagnant point depends on two parameters. One is the velocity ratio, which is peripheral velocity divided by the actual velocity of the stream. Mm-hmm. And also the absolute velocity of the fluid. So what happens is...
So what is the application of that, Ishan?
Sir, the application is to calculate the lift and drag forces. So what happens is in the upstream region, the piece stagnation moves towards the upstream region. And there is a negative pressure in the downstream region, due to which when it rotates, it tends to get lifted up, sir. So it is one way to explain the lift phenomena, because the stagnation point, suppose this is the flow and this is how the cylinder is rotating. So if I increase the speed, the stagnation point would initially be here. So it would go downwards, due to which there would be a lift, sir.
What do you understand by aerodynamics?
Sir, aerodynamics means it is a branch of science which deals with the study of fluid dynamics, which affects the lifts and drag, and again deriving the equations to find out how the velocity and ambient condition and the properties of fluid, like rho, viscosity, thermal.
What is the dynamics part in this dynamics?
So the dynamics part is this, that how if an object is flowing or if an object is flying, so what are the forces it would encounter, because it is flowing in a fluid region, and depending on that we need to optimize the structures so as to get
what are the main forces behind flow of air in the ambience.
So the main forces is pressure difference.
Mm-hmm. And what other than pressure difference, what can be the other criteria?
So the other criteria can be gravitational forces.
Suppose I want to extract wind energy, wind power.
Yes, sir.
Wind turbine, pata hai na tumhe, wind turbine hote hain.
Yes, sir.
They work on the principle of wind energy.
Right, sir.
That wind is flowing because of pressure difference or something else?
Sir, the wind is in wind turbine, the wind is flowing because of pressure difference initially, sir. That's the reason why the wind will initially flow. But again, you know,
is there any role of solar energy in that?
Yes, sir. The solar energy creates density difference in two parts of the earth.
How?
Sir, because wherever there is higher radiation, the more heat radiation would be there, heat flux would be there, which will decrease the density of the air. And some other part, there are high density. So the
can you name some places where wind energy is harnessed in the wind power plant? कहां पे लग सकते हैं विंड पावर प्लांट? कैन आई पुट विंड पावर प्लांट इन उत्तर प्रदेश, राजस्थान, कर्नाटका? वेयर शुड आई पुट? अगर आपके दिमाग में आया कि विंड पावर प्लांट लगाना है
तो
कहां लगाओगे?
कोस्टल एरिया में मैं
कोस्टल एरिया करूंगा। क्यों
सर? क्योंकि जो हीट जो एब्जॉर्प्शन करने की कैपेसिटी है दिन में क्या होता है कि जो लैंड होता है वो गर्म होता है, और रात में जो होता है रात में वो ठंडा होता है, क्योंकि वो जितनी जल्दी हीट ले पाता है उतनी जल्दी छोड़ता भी है। तो
क्या बोलते हैं इसको,
अगर
टेक्निकली क्या बोलते हैं इसको, जितनी जल्दी हीट ले लेता उतनी जल्दी हीट दे देता, क्या बोलते हैं इसको?
एब्जॉर्प्टिविटी एंड एमिसिविटी,
नहीं, दिस इज कॉल्ड हीट कैपेसिटी ऑफ वाटर एंड हीट कैपेसिटी ऑफ अर्थ।
यस यस, हीट कैपेसिटी ऑफ वाटर इज फार मोर देन द सैंड ड्यू टू विद द टेम्परेचर डिफरेंस इज डिफरेंट। तो उससे मैं ऐसी जगह पे रखूंगा जिसमें टेम्परेचर का डिफरेंस प्रीडोमिनेंट हो सके, मतलब लैंड और लैंड का ही अगर तुलना हो रहा है तो इतना नहीं हो पाएगा।
ठीक है, आई थिंक ओवर टू सकलानी सर नाउ।
Okay, so Chance, so I will be asking some of the questions related to strength of materials, maybe mixed up with the design also, right?
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir.
Because you have got the good morning. So you have got the call from mechanical as well, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so okay, so can you let me know have you heard about the name shear stress?
Shear stress, yes, sir.
Can you give me the examples in your home where shear stress will be acting?
Yes,
around
sir.
You, some of the applications or the objects in which you think that shear stress will be acting, or yes, you sir. May be applying.
Just now, like I had bread and butter. So while I was cutting the butter, so that is a phenomenon of shear stress. And when we wipe off the clothes, कपड़े जब धोते हैं, so we kind of apply torsion there. So this is also a example of shear force. And then, for example, I am sitting in the chair. So the structure which is supporting my my body will also get deformed. So there is complementary shear stress in between the layers, sir. So sir, anywhere I look, I found shear stress only. There are a lot of examples. Even if I see someone sitting in the bed, so if the there would be slight deformation in the bed also. So the surface of the bed where someone is sitting. So there also it will get bent like this. So between two layers, there would be complementary shear stresses.
Okay. So you mentioned about the complementary. Why there is complementary shear stress? Will it always be there, or sometimes it will be over there?
Sir, whenever a shear stress is applied, complementary shear must be there. The reason being that when we analyze strength of materials, the predominant condition is this, that the body should be in equilibrium. So if I put tau xy in x phase, tau xy in x phase, so there is a concline motion. So there must be anti-clockwise torque should be there in the y phase also, to so as to balance the rotation. So there should not be any rotational disbalance of torque. So that's the reason why complementary shear stress comes into play.
So is there any complementary normal stress also?
No, sir. Complementary normal stresses are not there, because if we consider x direction, so we automatically say that if we put 10 kilonewton, we will put 10 kilonewton in other direction also.
Okay. So you have heard the terms called as homogeneous materials and isotropic materials, right?
Yes, sir.
What is the difference between these two?
Okay, so I'll talk about homogeneous first. So homogeneous is, if we take a direction, so at all points, the properties in that direction would be same at all points. In isotropic, we consider one point and we say that in all the point, in that point, in all the direction, the properties would be same. So this is the difference, sir.
Okay. So in most of the cases, like whenever you analyze, you consider the material to be homogeneous and isotropic.
Yes, sir.
why don't you go ahead with maybe like with the homogeneous or maybe with the isotropic? Why most of the time as you assume for the analysis that let us assume the material is homogeneous and isotropic?
Sir, we must assume, otherwise we can't ever derive any equation in SOM. The reason is this, because we want the properties, let me consider as the Poisson's ratio, the E, G, K. So these properties should be exact in all the direction and all the points. Only then we can have the freedom to analyze the derive the equation. So that's the reason we want to have the property in all direction and at every point to be same. So we consider homogeneous and isotropic together, sir.
So is Poisson ratio the property of a material?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so what is its value?
Sir, the value depends on the material, sir. Like for metals, it's usually between 1/3 to 1/4 to 1/3. For cork, it is 0.5. And there are various other examples of that.
For cork, it is 0.5.
Yes, sir.
Why? What is the meaning of this 0.5?
Sir, 0.5 means like when we calculate the volumetric strain. So the volumetric strain comes out to be 1 minus 2 nu sigma x plus sigma y plus sigma z divided by E. So if we put nu equal to 0.5, it means that the volumetric strain would be 0, which means that agar cork ka material lete hai, usme hum forces dalte hai. So the lateral strain will balance each other's longitudinal strain and vice versa. So okay.
So let me just tell you the value of for this 0.5 again, right? It means that if you have a linear strain of 4.
Linear strain of, sir?
Linear strain is 4.
Okay.
4 number.
Yes, sir.
And the lateral strain is 2.
Right.
It will come out to 0.5?
No, sir. The lateral strain must be -2.
No. What I'm saying is, Poisson ratio will come out to be 0.5 only.
No, sir. Yes, sir.
Right. So yes, what I'm saying is, if lateral strain is 2 and linear strain is 4, it means it is coming out to be 0.5. It means if you are straining it by a value, let us say 4 linearly, then lateral strain is, that means laterally that dimension is decreasing
would
by
half. Yes, sir.
That is possible in cork.
Sir, I have not done the experiment, sir.
You are straining it by 4 kind of strain.
Yes,
and then lateral strain is almost half of that value. Right? That's what you are saying for cork.
Yes, sir. Theoretically, that's what I'm saying.
Practically, just talk practically also. Is it possible for you?
It's not possible. Again,
then why you are saying 5?
Because I have again assumed it to be homogeneous and isotropic, sir.
No, you as that's all. We have taken it as a homogeneous isotropic.
Yes,
we are not talking about that. I'm just simply saying that for cork, that means if you are straining by 4 mm, it is roughly getting lateral strain is roughly, or lateral dimension is shrinking by, let us say, by 2 mm, something that way, almost by half. Is it possible in cork?
No, sir. Sir, I'm not talking about the mm or something. I'm talking about the strain, sir.
Let's talk about strain. I'm just trying to make it simple. That's all. To make you understand physically.
Sir,
dimension only.
Sir, I have not done the experiment.
Can you give me the value of strain, Poisson ratio for this rubber? Approximate value?
No, sir. I don't recall, sir.
Okay. So, can you have a negative Poisson ratio?
Negative Poisson ratio. Sir, there can be substances where we can have, sir, but I have not read about it, sir. but there are so many exceptions in material science that I'm sure that one substance would be there which will show negative.
What is the meaning of negative Poisson ratio?
It means that if longitudinal strain is positive, so the lateral strain will be also positive, which means that if I'm elongating a bar, elongating a substance, so in lateral direction also it will expand. Sir.
So have you seen such material?
No, sir.
So is it possible to have such material?
Sir, probably it is because material science is all about exceptions. So probably
everything is all about the exceptions.
We not can all find about
exceptions in everything.
Yes, sir.
Isn't it? Why material science only?
Sir, because there are a lot of
okay. So you must have done the experiment in UTM, tensile testing in UTM.
Yes, sir.
Have you done?
Yes, sir.
During your college days?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so how did you measure the strain over there?
Sir, we put the piece between the two sections, and we put the load, and the strain is like in the computer it is shown what is the strain.
I'm not saying computer. I'm saying how did you measure, or how did the computer measure?
Sir, it takes the length, the initial length, and then depending upon the load, there would be changes in length.
What is that initial length?
Initial length, sir, I don't, 5.67. I don't remember, sir.
No, what is the name given to 5.67? Why you are saying 5.67 and all that? What is the name given to that length? Initial length that you're talking about.
I don't know, sir.
Okay, so Ehsan, before I proceed to ask further questions, I just recalled one question. I think that is related to your aerodynamics only. For example, you are having an aeroplane, right?
Yes,
so in which portion of the aeroplane lift is generated?
Sir, in the wings of the aeroplane, sir.
Wings of the aeroplane.
Yes, sir.
We want to modify this answer a little bit.
Sir, there probably no, sir. I'm not able to recall the exact name
okay.
of.
Okay. Anyway, so I'm giving you one. I'm showing you one figure. Just have a look over here. I've drawn it for you.
Yes, sir. You are putting a moment which is parallel to the moment's axis is parallel to the centroidal axis, right, sir?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir.
So, give me the value of stress. Give me the value of stress at point A.
Sir, zero.
Zero?
Yes, sir.
Why you are saying so?
Sir, because there is no resistance, because the moment is applied after point A. So it will freely rotate, sir. So basically the rotation at the point of the periphery of the section where moment is applied would be equal to the rotation of the air. So there is no resistance to it. That's it.
Just see it clearly. Okay. Now, what is the value of stress at point A?
So, you know, let me please, sir, if you allow, can I clarify that P is acting at the below point? And only P is acting, right, sir?
Right.
Okay. So P will generate a torque
draw it and show me. Tell me.
Yes, sir. There would be two shear stresses. One is due to the torque, and one is due to the transverse shear load, because the P is eccentric transverse shear load. So there would be three effects due to that. One is it will generate torque, due to which torsion will come. The second is it will generate a complementary shear stress. And the third one would be it will also bend a bit, but the bending effect will not come into play because it is there in the section only. So I need to consider the shear stress due to the torque. So if I calculate shear stress due to the torque, it would be P into R divided by Z polar.
Okay. Let me just show you one more figure. This is the figure for you.
Yes, sir.
Right. So tell me the value of stresses. Tell me what kind of stresses will be generated.
Okay. So first of all, shear stresses will be generated. Mm-hmm. Bending stresses will also be generated.
Mm-hmm.
So also, sir, can you please show me the diagram again, sir, if you don't mind? Yes, sir. Sir, that dot you are showing is, if I talk about the plane perpendicular to
exactly at the center.
Okay, exactly at the center. So it will give bending stress and shear stress, sir.
Mm-hmm. Okay. If I talk about the same figure that I had shown you earlier.
Yes, sir.
And just ignore all these. Okay. Just assume this is the torque which is acting.
Yes, sir.
So, if this particular rod is made up of glass, right? How this rod will fail and where?
Sir, the rod will fail at an angle 45 degree to the centroidal axis, sir. Because
take the element at the most critical section and show me the stresses and explain with the help of that.
Yes, sir. So the critical section would be the between where the moment is applied and the fixed point, because all throughout the moment is same, and state of stress diagram would be like this.
Mm-hmm.
And the Mohr circle would be like this.
Mm-hmm.
So the principal stress would be plus tau and minus tau. So as we know, glass is a brittle material, so it is weak in tension. So that's the reason why it will break at an angle 45 degrees. Because at the angle 45 degree, there is maximum tensile stress.
Okay, so now I think we can give him a feedback. Right. So let me just give the feedback, Hassan, first, and then I think Dr. Vijender can continue.
Yes.
Hassan, देखो ऐसा है overall तो मुझे ठीक लगा आपका, but कुछ एक points हैं where you are committing mistakes. ठीक है. Later part आप बड़े अच्छे से बता पाए, मतलब properly सोचा भी आपने और properly explain कर पाए. Initial part में थोड़ा सा आपने initial part में भी ठीक था, but mostly आप you committed mistake in poison ratio. Poison ratio आपने जो है या तो वो simply you have crammed the values and all that, you have not studied it properly. उसको थोड़ा सा ढंग से देख लो, समझो मतलब क्या हुआ उसका. फॉर एग्जाम्पल इफ यू आर टॉकिंग अबाउट कॉर, कॉर का आपने जो है कॉर की वैल्यू जो है इट इज नॉट लाइक गोइंग टू बी नियर अबाउट 0.5, इट इज गोइंग टू बी नियर अबाउट 0. 0 की तरफ को इसकी वैल्यू ज्यादा 0 होगी. मतलब ये है कि अगर आप इस डायरेक्शन में स्ट्रेन कर रहे हो तो लेटरल डायरेक्शन में स्ट्रेन ऑलमोस्ट निग्लिजिबल है. तो डोंट जस्ट क्रैम दीज फिगर्स और दीज वैल्यूज. Just understand the meaning. क्या मतलब है इसका कि मैं इस direction में खींच रहा हूँ, मान लिया तो अगर compression हो रही है उससे perpendicular direction में, transfer direction में, that is almost negligible. That is how is the property of torque. Rubber के case में you can say more or less that is around 0.5 and all that. क्योंकि आप खींच रहे हो यहाँ से तो perpendicular direction में, transverse direction में भी significant reduction हो रही है, maybe around half of that value. तो इसका physical significance देखो, केवल जो है cram करके जाना है, cram किया था आपने value. अब ये भूल गए आप, आपने बोलना था उसके लिए रबर के लिए, बट यू स्पोक अबाउट कॉर्क एंड व्हेन आई एक्सप्लेन आस्क यू टू एक्सप्लेन यू आर नॉट एबल टू जस्टिफाई योर आंसर. ठीक है, क्रैम मत करो. अच्छा, एक बेसिक क्वेश्चन मैंने पूछा आपसे रिलेटेड टू दिस हाउ वी मेजर दिस स्ट्रेन इन यूटीएम. आपने बोला कंप्यूटर अपने आप मेजर करता है, कोई तो मैकेनिज्म होगा, कुछ तो यूज करते होंगे आप. आपने बोलता लेंथ के बीच, व्हाट इज द लेंथ. हाँ, स्ट्रेन गेज, या तो स्ट्रेन गेजेस का यूज करो, एक्सटेंसोमीटर भी होता है उसमें, तो वैसे नॉर्मली स्ट्रेन गेज ही लगी होगी. ठीक है, तो उसको यूज करते हैं, कहाँ पर यूज करते हैं. तो इन दैट सैंपल दैट यू हैव टेकन, वी फर्स्ट मार्क द पॉइंट्स जिसके ऊपर हमने मेजर करनी होती है एज पर द स्टैंडर्ड. जो भी स्टैंडर्ड आप ले रहे हो, ASTM ले रहे हो, JIS ले रहे हो, जो भी स्टैंडर्ड ले रहे हो, एज पर दैट स्टैंडर्ड वहां पर दो पॉइंट्स मार्क करते हो आप. उस लेंथ को क्या बोलते हैं हम, गेज लेंथ, वी कॉल इट एज ए गेज लेंथ. तो व्हेन वी मेजर दिस चेंज इन लेंथ over that particular gauge length, तो आपको वो term पता ही नहीं है gauge length क्या है. ठीक है, and then with the help of that वो फिर उसको reflect करता है, तो force reflection diagram आपका जो है उसमें आपका reflect हो जाता है UTM में. and then if you will feed the value of original cross section area, original length, तो वो आपका system जो है उसको convert कर देता है stress strain diagram पे, but original जो है आपका force reflection diagram draw हो जाता है उसमें, क्योंकि जो value system जो है actual measure करती है machine. तो ये थोड़ा सा आप गो थ्रू इट, मुझे लग रहा है बाकी पोर्शन जो आपने, मुझे लग रहा है यू आर एबल टू एक्सप्लेन इट करेक्टली और उसमें आप सोच भी रहे थे, अप्लाई कर रहे थे एंड देन यू गिविंग द आंसर. तो अच्छा, एक लिफ्ट का है जो मैंने क्वेश्चन बीच में वैसे ही ध्यान आया मुझे. नॉर्मली पूरी बॉडी में जो है लिफ्ट जनरेट होती है, कोई पार्ट नहीं है. विंग्स तो आपकी सिग्निफिकेंट लिफ्ट जनरेट करते हैं, बट दैट डज नॉट मीन कि बाकी बॉडी में लिफ्ट जनरेट नहीं होता. लिफ्ट जो पूरी पूरी बॉडी इंक्लूडिंग दैट यूर उसमें विंग्स जो है वो लिफ्ट जनरेट होती है. ठीक है,
मैंने पूछा था, दे आर गोइंग टू मेक अ लिंक एंड मेकिंग यू थिंक मोर अबाउट दैट पर्टिकुलर कॉन्सेप्ट. सो इन सच क्वेश्चंस यू हैव टू टेक टाइम एंड थिंक एंड देन गिव आंसर. There is no correct or incorrect answer for that. They will only prompt you to think. They just want to check your thinking capability. That's it. So like the drop is falling, you should have drawn a diagram, taken some time and then thought and given answer. And they will give you sufficient time to think and answer because they want to check your thinking pattern. So unlike other interviews in which you know the answer and you give the answer, in IIC or ISRO or research organizations, the pattern is like you don't give answer immediately, you think and then give answer, because all the questions are thought provoking question. These questions will make you think. If you don't think, you cannot find the answer, and they don't give you marks on the basis of correct or incorrect answer. They give you marks on the basis of approach you are following. like drop me, had you told me case, okay sir, the drop is falling, relative motion of air is there, and some parts of this drop water is getting vaporized, so mass is also decreasing, that factor also we need to consider, sir. So that is sufficient for me. No, whether you consider that or you are capable to get actual equation or not, that is immaterial, but at least you thought in that direction, that is sufficient for me. Mathematics, go for Tyagi sir, mathematics ka, certainly they are going to ask you question for maths, so go for SNAP maths with Tyagi sir, that is what I recommend. Baki, Bernoulli equation is used on a streamline, that is what I was trying to ask you. You draw a streamline at the two section and you use the Bernoulli equation at the two points on particular streamline. It is not used at any particular point on the section, it is used on particular point on that particular streamline, which is passing through section one and section two. That is the concept I was trying to get the answer from you. Just the rest is, I think, as Saklani sir said, you have the basics, but approach, please improve the approach.
Okay, so sir, what do you mean by approach, sir? Like,
that is what I was explaining all this time. Approach means think and then answer.
Okay.
Right? Think and then answer. Don't come to the answer immediately. You can think, like a water drop wale case mein, you could have thought of all these factors which I told you now. But yes, you did not think that these factors.
Yes,
right?
Yes, sir.
This is what you have to do. Chalo, prepare well for this and then go for. When is your interview of IIC Bangalore?
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow, no? Chalo, all the best and prepare well for that.
Yes.
And prepare well your BTEC project also, that is very relevant for these departments which you are going.
Yes, sir.
Revise that well, huh? BTEC
right.
Project also.
Right.
Okay, Asan, all the best.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.